Well, welcome to today's special webinar presented by the College Music Society. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to introduce today's presentation entitled A National Conversation on Music Education in Higher Ed at the Crossroads of Real Change. This, the fifth of our special series of webinars related to the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, will feature colleagues with expertise related to music education. Our nation's music educators have been especially hard hit during the pandemic, yet they have shown characteristic resourcefulness and dedication as curricula have converted almost overnight to online platforms. And now the music education world is confronted with students' needs for sustainable music learning during the long haul of this challenging time. We continue to recognize that COVID's effects will last much longer than we imagined, and it is obvious that those effects will touch every musician of every age in some way. During this 75-minute webinar, you will hear from six colleagues from K through 12 and higher education programs across the US. Today's panel includes Jeanette Revel Barrett, the Marilyn Flaterer Zimmerman Endowed Chair in Music Education at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. Christian Bonner, a 2020 graduate in music education from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Constance McCoy, the Marion Stedman Covington Distinguished Professor of Music Education at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. Amanda Soto, Associate Professor of Music Education at Texas State University. Tony White, Coordinator of Music and Entertainment Education for the Los Angeles Unified School District Beyond the Bell Branch. And Jaquan Wiley, Assistant Director of Bands at Asheville High School in North Carolina. We have over 200 colleagues registered for this webinar, which we are also recording for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. If you're attending from outside the US, please let us know that via the chat function. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce the moderator for today's webinar, Terrell Dobbs, CMS's board member for music education and professor and chair for music education at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Welcome, Terry.
Thank you so much, Bill, and thank you so much, panelists, for joining us today, and thank you, attendees. It's just a pleasure and a privilege to join you today. This panel came about this summer in conversation with the president of CMS, Professor Eileen Hayes, and wondering about where is music education at this time of convergence. We're in the middle of the pandemic of COVID-19 and converging with real change, we hope, from the Black Lives Matter movement. So in coming together, I've asked the panelists a series of questions about where are we? What does this mean for change in music education at the higher ed level? And by multiple stakeholders in music education, those of us who are teaching in higher education, and those of us here on the panel today who are working with teachers and also new teachers. And so I'm going to turn this over to Professor Jeanette Revel Barrett. And my first question is, what can the present moment, the confluence of the Black Lives Matter movement with the COVID-19 pandemic, mean for music education in higher ed? And then I have a follow-up question. Are we at kind of a particular moment, Jeanette? So I look forward to hearing what you have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry, and thank you, Bill. And thank you for a question that is daunting in all of its dimensions and multifaceted and engaging and meaningful and pertinent for us, urgent, in fact. So in thinking about this, I've had the question follow me around for several days, and indeed we've been in this space now for some time thinking about these things that have happened to business as usual since the middle of March. And I think that what it means for music ed is serious and significant in lots of different ways. The pandemic, I want to start with the pandemic and then move toward the Black Lives Matter movement. The pandemic has brought about great disruption for higher education. It's disrupted the way we think about our interactions with students, it's disrupted our schedules, it's disrupted some of the things that have been so part and parcel of the way that we do business that we scarcely think about them anymore. I have often read Larry Cuban and David Tyack, and they talk about the grammars of schooling and the grammars of a school of music we know well. It's the things that we take for granted because they seem to be so prevalent and so ingrained in what we do. So the pandemic has caused those things to be dislodged and to loosen up. And the responses to the pandemic at this point in time seem to be a lot about the technical aspects of how we're going to move forward. And I don't dismiss that or diminish it. And in fact, the pandemic brings to our lives incredible sadness when we think about the magnitude of it for the lives of our students and the persons in our communities. It just stops us in our tracks to think about the suffering that the pandemic has brought to us. I want to also be mindful, though, that in this time of the pandemic, the Black Lives Matter movement, which, I mean, in many ways, the pervasive and endemic notions of racism have been part of this country from its founding. But this summer, there was this uprising, and long overdue, right? Long overdue, and triggered by horrific events. And because we're paying attention to those in a way, in this kind of cloud of the pandemic, my hope is that the lessons that we learn and the conversations that we have about Black Lives Matter, racism, the pervasiveness of whiteness in our schools of music will be something that even after we work through the technicalities of living through a pandemic, those conversations are sustained. Those conversations last. The kinds of changes we need to make will mobilize so many people across so many disciplines and dialogues to make substantive and significant change to business as usual in schools of music. So embedded in that enormous question is the thought, well, what does music ed have to do with this? What can music ed do with this? And I've thought long and hard about what makes music ed particularly informative or useful or a source of action and reconsideration in these times. And I've come up with a couple of ideas that I think might help us as music educators think about our contributions to the problems at hand. One of the reasons that I think music ed is so well positioned is to think about the way that we have long had audiences beyond the college students who are right in front of us. The pre-K through 12 students who are ultimately the persons with whom we are oriented. We want to change their lives. We want to infuse their lives with music through the teachers that go out to work with them. And so that broadness of scope, those purposes and aims that are already quite large, have been part of how we think of ourselves as music educators. I teach in a state institution. So I have to think all the time about how what we do in music ed serves the children of the state of Illinois. And to me, that mandate means that we have to change the way that we do business, that we have to change some of these grammars. The second part of this, because I don't want to capture too much time here, but the second part of Terry's question about, you know, what are we at a moment? Well, the answer is yes. It's a long overdue moment. It's a moment that we need to embrace as fully and as wholeheartedly with humility and with resolve that we can, right? What do those opportunities look like? And because this question is so broad, and because the dimensions of racism and whiteness and changing the way schools of music operate is so daunting, I'd like for us to think about three particular realms. One realm is, what can we do with our music education colleagues to look most closely at our teacher preparation, to think about the choices and the aims and the experiences that we think are so important to prepare music teachers for a changing world. I want to think about the second realm being across schools of music. I think that music educators have a lot that we can learn from our colleagues, and that we can also engage our colleagues in conversation about because of the scope, because of the breadth of our interests and our purposes in music education. And then the third realm is our outward facing realm, that certainly, as I've talked about, those students in our communities, but also to think about the association work that we do. That's part of our outward facing work as well. What are the particular ways that the College Music Society, which represents so many domains, what are some of the ways that we can capitalize on that and use the resources and the energies of music education to address some of these things in ways that will be sustained, significant, meaningful, and will rise to the daunting challenges that we face in so many different ways. So I've probably just made your question bigger, but as a preface to all of this, I look forward to what we learn here in this brief moment that will move forward toward those aims and those purposes.
Janet, thank you so much. Who would like to respond to Dr. Barrett's? Christian, please.
I just want to say, Janet, that those answers were very similar to what my own personal experiences were. I grew up biracial I'm from Naperville, so I really understand how Illinois music education works. And so when it came time for me to think about where I wanted to go to school, I was really thinking about what is a music education program that is going to value me as a student, but also value me as a performer. And I think what this time between Black Lives Matter and COVID really is giving us the chances to look at music education as the encompassing notion of what higher education of a music school is. And I think we've really had to think about, you know, performance faculty have had to think about how are we going to educate our students in private lessons, theory faculty, all these other faculty members that don't necessarily have to think as creatively on how do we teach our students as, say, we do. And I think there's this idea that music education is this niche little small group of students that are not as good performers and are pushed off to the side and often are neglected. And I think we have this time to really say, like, music education is what a school of music is. You know, we embody what the goals of a school of music are, and especially at a state institution, like, I'm the one going out to serve the state. And so when we have, talking again from my personal experiences at Wisconsin, you know, I often felt neglected, both as a music student and because of the color of my skin. I was the only person of color in the music ed program across how many different degree levels. And, you know, everybody would look at me as soon as the word race came up. And so that really challenged me to think about how do I go and serve a state that is extremely segregated and looking at that. And so I really want to challenge us as, like, and I challenge myself as we move forward, is how can we take music education and encompass and embody the spirit of what schools of music are and what they want to accomplish, because we're the ones that are keeping them going.
Right, thank you, thank you. Anyone else? Amanda, please.
Thank you for your beautiful words, Janet and Christian. And, you know, I think I had this conversation with Connie maybe last month, but I think that with everything going on, this is a push towards changing the system. And I think we need to capitalize on it now, and we need to go in and fight for changes within the system. within the music curriculum, music education curriculum, within the music curriculum? What are our expectations? Looking at the gatekeepers, who gets in, who doesn't get in, and really figure out why that is happening in specific areas, because it's different for each institution. I think we're at a crossroads right now. And I think people will look back at this time and say, because of this, what did you do? How did you change? How did you move forward and adapt and figure this out? And so I think it's up to us, and a call out to all people, all music educators and music professors and faculty at the institutions, to say, to look inward, to look at the practices, to look at our teaching practices, our curriculum, and how do we change our individual classes, but then how do we work together to make systemic change? And if we don't do this now, I'm afraid we'll lose the opportunity, and we won't have that social capital that is behind us right now, because it's really easy to forget about that. And the worry here is that there is so much more going on with COVID, that might get lost, you know, but I think making the push, starting the conversations, I think is really important.
Great. Thank you so much, Amanda. And that leads me to my next question for Connie. What processes and practices do you think need to change in music education at the higher ed level, and why?
At some of our speakers have already touched on some of these ideas. I think in general, there has been a need for a long time for us to rethink what music education looks like. We have for a very, very long time had what I would call a traditional idea of what music education is, and it's been reflected in the tendency to categorize our music making or our musical settings in terms of general music, instrumental, choral. And while I understand in some sense that there are reasons for that, one of the things that has happened from my perspective with regard to COVID-19 and the Black Lives Matter movement is that it has really forced us to rethink the status quo, because the status quo has been disrupted. One of the things that I think is really important or has come, and I'll talk about the effects of COVID first, and then I'll talk about the Black Lives Matter movement. In terms of COVID, with teachers getting online and looking to each other for resources in terms of how to teach virtually, I think it's forced teachers to rethink what music making looks like or can look like. There have been loads of choral directors wanting to know how they can do the Eric Whitaker thing, how they can provide opportunities for people to sing in groups when not being able to be together. But even on a deeper level, I think that the idea of the questions that have come about music making, music teaching and music making, and using technology for that has forced us to understand that there are other kinds of music making. There have been kids who've been out using technology to create and perform for years, but you wouldn't know that as reflected in our music teacher education programs. And so in that sense, I think COVID-19 has forced us in many ways to rethink what music making has been looking like in terms of technology and what it can look like. So there's this idea of the relationship between technology and music teaching and the relationship between technology and music making that I think COVID-19 has brought to the forefront. In terms of the Black Lives Matter movement, I think it is true what Janet said about this coming to the forefront this summer for lots of reasons. This isn't something new. These conversations that are happening now have been happening in small places for years and years and years. What's been interesting to me is that for the first time in my own personal experience, I have seen people actually accepting the notion of institutional racism as a thing, as a real thing. And so this focus on how that is manifested in institutions like schools of music is now something that people are ready to talk about. So when it comes down to what processes and practices need to change, some of them, like what Amanda mentioned about the gatekeeping, what the policies that are in place that determine who gets to become a music educator have to be critically analyzed. There are changes that need to happen both in terms of the human diversity in our institutions and the musical diversity in our institutions. And I think they are particularly significant in music education because, as has been mentioned before, we are preparing teachers who are going to go out and work with kids from preschool through 12th grade. And we have a responsibility in that we have to prepare teachers who have the capacity to teach in ways that not only correspond and are relevant to the students that they're working with, but also have correspond and have value for the communities in which they will, where the schools reside in which they will be teaching. And so that means that it's, as far as I'm concerned, this disposition that all types of music are valid and have value. And the idea that students really need to see teachers who look like them in their classrooms. Those two things to me go hand in hand. And it's the point of entry that I think is the place, one of the places to begin. I happen to have a perspective that says that we need to address some of these issues simultaneously. It's the point of entry at higher education level. It's our professional organizations, and it's also what how teachers work with students in P-12 contexts. But as far as the point of entry is concerned, I think we really need to critically examine the policies and the requirements we have for entry, because as they currently stand, they tend to be highly exclusive. And then we also need to look at our curriculum to see ways in which we might be able to decenter Western European art music. And give students an opportunity to experience other kinds of music making. Because if we acknowledge that music and culture are intimately connected, then we recognize that music has value to different cultures and different people in those cultures, and that to study and perform, it's impossible to me to study and perform various types of musics without also having an understanding of the people who are making those music. And so we have a lot of work to do, you know, if we are going to expand the diversity of the students that are in our programs, our music education programs at the collegiate or university level, and if we are going to expand the types of music making that our students engage with when they are in it going through our programs, then we have some examination that must happen. I want to make sure I didn't miss something that I was going to say. And that's obviously going to be different depending on where we are. But There is one word I'll mention it now because I don't want to forget it. I've been engaged with at least two other conferences virtually over the summer. And one word that has come up consistently that I think is incredibly important, and it may relate to another question that will come up, is this idea of intentionality. We have to be intentional about this. This isn't something that's going to, you know, happen by accident. We have to recognize the problem and we have to be intentional about rectifying. It's no longer a question of checking boxes anymore.
Thank you so much, Connie. Who would like to respond? Tony, please.
Wow, let's say, Connie, that was very powerful. And it's making me reflect right now where I am. I just want to, first of all, say I'm honored to be here on this panel and listen to what's happening across the country. I'm in Los Angeles. And what you said about is about the point of entry, which is really intriguing to me, is that we have to make sure that students coming out of college and those people, our colleagues in the field, understand that what we're doing is a living body and it always has to be adjusted. And we're going to always be looking for how we deal with these issues. You know, so obviously during this time of COVID now, things that would not probably register as highly is now, is everything is ultra sensitive. And we see that happening every day. I can't pick up the LA Times without seeing some sort of story about something that's happening that has either been systemically passed down and or, you know, now as we're concerned as educators about where do we go with music and music making? And is it going to be around? Is it, you know, I find myself asking after being involved for over 30 years, you know, what does the future of music making look like? And how are we going to be able to advocate? And I, one thing I always talk to when I receive new teachers in our district is I really try to make sure that I put them underneath my wings and really try to mentor them, because I know that a lot of times, unless they're at a school of the arts or a school where they may have a leader that is really sensitive and wants to make it successful, that they're going to encounter a lot of doubt and they're going to encounter a lot of problems, for lack of better words, is that because if people don't understand what it is to have a comprehensive sequential music program or to make sure that it's not that it exists after they leave, or sometimes if they're stepping into a program where it's been, you know, dismantled for several years. How do we rebuild that? I always talk about, you know, we see that, you know, the movie Mr. Holland's Opus, we talk, you know, we see that program, he built a program from nothing, all of a sudden the end, you know, he was kind of pushed out, et cetera, et cetera. That's something that we as music educators are always going to have to be, you know, making sure that the advocacy level on the community and the school district, the schools, et cetera, those things, we need to really build infrastructures. And I look at that as building from the ground up and planting those seeds and nurturing them. And so the music educator, and in my view, you know, it's like, you know, you got to do a lot of push-ups, a lot of be ready for it, and you have to think ahead. And I know that's, and it's like, in some ways, putting a lot of burden on our future music educators in K-12. But I think the same thing I see happening even in college and university levels is where you are constantly monitoring the scene, and you're basically, to quote Hamilton, you want to be in the room where it happens. And you bring that voice, all of us here bring that voice at different levels to make sure that, you know, we are not the stepchildren. You know, we are, we belong at the table. We need to have a nourishing thoughts for us, and we need to make sure that we are not left behind.
Thank you so much, Tony. And that leads me to a question that I'm just going to open up to anyone. So what changes or conversations are you now experiencing in your institutions?
Well, I'd like to jump back in for a minute. just with a brief preface to what I'm going to say, which is this is my 44th year of teaching, and I have been part of curricular change in various institutions of higher education. And there's always been sort of an unspoken rule when we were thinking about changing the music ed curriculum, which was don't mess with the core music curriculum, right? Music theory, music history, ensembles, applied study, because it's just too intractable. It's too hard to change. You can't move that mountain. Work with the things that you can move. Well, I'm just pretty astonished that I am seeing, and it's not to say, you know, that music ed is any better, but I'm seeing a willingness to talk about that core curriculum in ways that I've never seen before. At the University of Illinois, our director, Jeffrey Spazzato, put out a call to a small group of people who'd already sort of named themselves as renegades who wanted to think about this question. And we started to talk about how could this core be different than what it is, right? How could the way that we define music not always be Western European art music? Although we'll certainly still have that, but how can we broaden it, enhance, and elaborate? And so we started with a little group of 8 to 10 of us having this conversation, and then we thought, well, let's open the gates and just invite anybody else to come join us. And now we're up to 20 people, 20 faculty members. And we've been rotating in through the music theorists have talked about what they think are the openings and the ways that they can change, like you were saying, Tony, in a dynamic way, right? Even though there are traditions that they still hold dear, there are other things that they think it's time to think fresh about these. And then the musicologists are next. And then the applied study people, and even class piano. And then the ensemble conductors are all participating in these conversations. Now, it's very early to say what serious and significant and tangible changes will come of it, but the conversations are remarkable. And so I've many times sat back to say, you know, maybe I should have poked at the mountain earlier than this, because there are ways that we can have these conversations, and maybe music ed can help to be a catalyst in getting those started. But it seems to me like there's a receptivity for thinking about what is music in our schools of music? Who are the musicians? What do we hope for their lives, right? And those sorts of broad-based conversations are, for me, a real invitation for broad conversation and dialogue that will move to action.
Thank you, Janet. Jaquan, what about from your perspective as, you know, a band director, you're out there in the field, what are you seeing, experiencing?
You know, it is, it's a little bit of everything. It's, there's some understanding. There are, you know, there are some people whose stars are aflame, to quote James Baldwin, you know, but, I'm very fortunate to, work in a community, and to teach at an institution where, it is where everyone is either on the same page or very quickly coming around to asking the tough questions and wanting to be part of the tough discussions. And a lot of what's going on is not always easy to talk about, and that's but I love having those conversations. You know, there it's sometimes I'm approached. And they're like, you know, I have a question. You know, I don't want to come off the wrong way. And I said, no. Let's sit down. Let's talk about this. And so, I definitely have found it most. I would say I've found it very opening and very enlightening to be a part of these discussions, and for people that want to have these conversations, for sure. And actually, back to an earlier point. Where Connie had mentioned curriculum. That is something that I have always been very, very high on and very, very just adamant about, is what's in our curriculum, what are we teaching? to our students, not just solely in band, but, you know, because we teach nine students, 9 through 12, and we have all kinds of students in the classroom, and they're saying, you know, well, we're learning this and we're learning that. And I say that, well, are you learning, well, what are the, are you learning the intricate interworkings of this, or are, you know, or are you just learning the surface? And they're like, well, what do you mean by that? And so I say, well, you know, to learn about the surface, okay, if you're learning about a culture, the surface is, you know, you learn about the dress and the regalia, and you learn about the dances, and say that's very important, it's very nice too, but the intricate inner workings are you learning about the culture and the values, and the unbesmirched historical context that comes with such things. You know, if we were teaching our students about William Grant Still, and we were to say, and is it enough just to say that William Grant Still was an African-American composer? I certainly don't think so. But those intricate inner workings are, well, he was the first African-American composer to write a symphony, okay, and to incorporate the African-American ideals of the time into his symphony. Is it enough to just teach our students about that Billie Holiday was a famous Black singer, or is it important for us to talk about whenever she eerily serenaded us about strange fruit, blood on the leaves, and blood at the root? You know, it's absolutely important that that we have these that we continue to have these open discussions. And so in my particular institution and community, it's been nice to talk about such things.
Jaquan, thank you so much. And that reminds me of not only the what, but the why and the how behind it. So important. I have to move on to a question for Amanda. And then, so Christian, hang on to your question. And well, I want to get to you, but Amanda, what sorts of support or levels of freedom restrictions are you experiencing as you engage in change at your own institution?
All right, thank you. I feel like I'm at a really special place here at Texas State University, which is located in San Marcos, Texas, right in between San Antonio and Austin. And obviously Texas has a large Latino population, and we have a really vibrant Latin music studies area that John Lopez has been building for over 20 years. So faculty over time have seen how well run it's been, how well the students have done, and now with, you know, with master's degrees that they can get in these studies, and with first it was a certificate and then a minor in mariachi education, and now we've actually gotten, well, we thought we got through a mariachi concentration, although there have been some issues in that recently, and so I think it's still on hold and hasn't been passed since all of last year that we worked hard on it, which is really frustrating. But there was still, even with the number of schools that have full-time mariachi teachers and vibrant mariachi programs, it was still a struggle to kind of get that through the concentration. So now you can be band, choir, orchestra, or like it's choral, instrumental, and then there's a mariachi track. I'm hoping it's going to get through because it was supposed to have already gotten through. But anyways, that is significant in terms of who can get in, who decides. Like, so in the past, a mariachi student could come in, but they had to go in through their private lesson studio, and their private lesson studio, their audition was in classical music, and they decided whether they got into the School of Music or not. And so those were some of the barriers and the gatekeepers. And with this degree, that changes. Their studio teachers are mariachi folks. They're not performers and professors in the field. You know, they're not studio teachers teaching classical. And then mariachi is something that they do on the side. So I'm very grateful for that. It's one of the reasons why I came to Texas State. But there's still a lot of pushback. I'm in Texas. Band is huge here in Texas. Choir, orchestra as well. And I still can't even get a multicultural or a world music pedagogy course, you know, how to teach a diversity of musics in the curriculum. There still won't make the space for it. And I still, you know, and then there's still these conversations again as others have mentioned, you know, changing that music curriculum and that music core. The mariachi concentration, we felt like we were constrained because we wanted to change some of that music core to match what this music genre would be. But we felt like if we went too far, we wouldn't get it passed. So we're still trying to mold ourselves to this old music curriculum or this music curriculum that's there just so that we can get in the door. And that's been really frustrating. And again, you know, if I got the course, you know, the World Music Pedagogy that also deals with culturally responsive teaching and these kinds of issues, there's issues just in that because that's one course and it shouldn't just be in one course, right? All of these issues should be talked about in all their band choral method classes or technique classes and all of these kinds of issues. So I don't know, I'm hopeful that maybe there can be some change, but it's hard because no one wants to give up the space, no one wants to give up the classes and the degree plans. And I really feel like we would need some support at higher and upper administration from the director of the School of Music, from the dean, from upper administration, say we need to get this in because they're still, even though they're supporting, you know, the BLM and all these other things, you know, they still kind of hold tight to, well, we need this because there are teachers, you know, that need this knowledge to be successful band directors and choir directors and orchestra directors and elementary teachers in the classroom. But so it's a little bit harder in Texas, but we've still made some really great progress. And I'm kind of excited to see what can happen as we move forward. But the one thing that worries me is that with COVID, universities, we've already cut a lot of people. People are going on full, like total full teaching loads. And you know, when there's no space to think about these things and to make those curricular changes, sometimes when we contract our budgets, you know, sometimes we go back to just the old school, old way of doing it. And there's not a lot of expansion for growth. So that's one thing that kind of worries me is like, how can we, I mean, right away with this concentration, we're already talking about, okay, well, we had factored in faculty over the next few years. Well, are we going to get to those faculty when all the budgets are shrinking and they're saying no more, right? So I'm just a little worried, but I'm still hopeful and excited of the progress that we've made here.
Yeah, great. So there's such a danger of that regression toward the mean, toward what the norm and, you know, shrinking it to, you know, what we have done. So Tony, if you would like to respond to Amanda and then from your perspective, how do we create and sustain conversations and still, you know, advocate for change, you know, for the long haul?
Well, I'm going to say that B word is always around budgets. And I think that during this time that we've got to be very smart and really look out the non-traditional budget ways or streams to bring resources in towards our programs. We know they're out there. I mean, that's another job by itself. But at the same time, I do want to rearticulate with Amanda a little bit about, you know, the mariachi curriculum. You didn't understand, you're probably really aware, you know, how long it took for jazz to become part of the curriculum and now that we have a flourishing of jazz schools. But also I want to go even deeper and talk about the importance of about having our teachers prepared to deal with any situations they may encounter. And not think about it as a traditional choir, band, and, you know, orchestra strand. It's not. We have to be able to show to our communities that we are addressing the needs of kids, and we're addressing the needs of kids through different forms of music. And then also, too, we go in as the educators, and we have to look at the community and figure out how do we tap into the various kids in our community so that we are talking to them, not only about how to make music and what music is, but how too that they could be a catalyst for change when they move on from their experience, whether they're music majors or not, but they're going to be sensitive and they're going to be aware and they're going to help to spur conversations about what music has done for them. I give an example. I had the great honor of talking with former President Bill Clinton, and he talks about how it was about him being in music and how that has allowed him, you know, obviously to where his career has taken him, regardless of the politics. But just to be able to have a person on that platform of that nature to talk about his involvement with music is powerful by itself. So I think that when we look at all of our traditional things, what we know, and I know all of us now are thinking about, again, we all are looking at reimagining what needs to happen as we, you know, next couple of weeks as schools are going to get started, and I'm not sure why everybody else, our schools are starting online. What does that look like? And I think that we're going to be constantly asking ourselves this question. And two, you know, I think, you know, the great thing about being in music is that this is a lifetime endeavor for us. We don't have to really retire from this. We know we can retire from that position, but, you know, how are we going to constantly advocate and really, you know, whether it's having that lunch or that dinner and just getting people to start thinking differently and look at who the power players are as it moves and make sure they understand about what we are, what we do, and why it's important. And I think that's very powerful. So I wish you luck with that. I mean, you know, and all of us here, that's what we're in it for, right? So I think, Terry, the next part of my conversation was about, you know, how do we create and sustain these conversations, which we are doing right now. I think during this time here of Zoom, especially, I think we've already started these broader conversations, just all of us here on this panel here today. And those of you who are listening at home, you know, sometimes as music educators, we are in our little silos. We stay, you know, people don't know what we do and we don't know what they do. And we just keep moving and, you know, ants marching, you know, but I think everything now has been, it's blown up for a reason. And now wherever those reasons are, we're analyzing that. But at the same time, I think we need to really try to grab on to what is happening and how do we make the best of it. I think that's how this started. We started the conversation with Janet was saying earlier about how do we take this and really, you know, use it towards as a main catalyst. And I think sometimes what we don't realize is that, you know, first of all, we're doing so much, we don't realize that. So it's okay once in a while to say, let's watch and live in and see how this is going and how can we help to shape it towards what we're doing. This is the first year in 73 years that they haven't been a term in a Roses Parade. This is my first year in 33 years that I have not done the Rose Parade. Okay. And I'm thinking like, oh my God, what does this look like? What am I going to do being home on New Year's Eve and all these other things that I've never done before? But yet I'm trying to really think about it in terms of how do I create a stronger advocacy? How do I make sure that I'm still engaging with students? How do we make sure we're engaging with the community? Because this is an anomaly. And we're going to come back from this and we're going to be ready. And so I've already like spoken to my supervisors and I'm preparing to speak to board members, whatever. Don't cut our budget. We're coming back. We're going to be better and stronger than ever. You know, and then also too, how do we, you know, make sure again that now that, you know, this is probably the time when we can really, really get into teaching our kids. You know, it doesn't have to be just about teaching for the performance. Now we can get in there and say, you know, can you play this minor scale? Do you know the sounds of this, how your instrument is sounding within the voices of our ensembles? And why your voice is important to making the ensemble sound better. Everybody can put, you know, have a little more emphasis on the individual, which makes the ensemble sounds better. I'm using that approach and, you know, and again, the different things that I'm tackling and it's scary. It's scary for everybody. But I think that this, you know, is the right time. And then, you know, to quote a little bit from John Lewis, you know, we always got to be ready for the good fight. And I think what we're all doing here is a good fight, right? It's, you know, and inclusion, you know, and that's dealing with all the different identity areas. It's about, you know, having our living testimony about keeping things going. I think about, I could not imagine someone knowing they're going to get beat up, you know, and going to get attacked by dogs or whatever it is, going up and saying, I'm going to go out to the Pettus Bridge that Sunday morning. I can't imagine that, right? But now I think about, he had that courage to do that. That means all of us here have to maintain our courage and really keep moving that forward for the betterment of our society and for our kids.
Definitely, Tony. And another thing that John Lewis talked about was get into good trouble, necessary trouble. Maybe that's what we're doing in Music Ed, is getting into good trouble. And with that, I have two more questions I want to get to both Christian and Jaquan. But Christian, you know, kind of working with Tony's comments, what ideas do you have from your perspective as a recent graduate for music education moving forward?
First, I just want to say that was so beautifully put, and it makes it very difficult to follow. In a sense, I'm trying to, like, how do I formulate it so it sounds just as eloquent? And so I have a couple ideas. One of the biggest issues that I have in, I'm looking at K-12 right now, and then I'll go to higher ed. In K-12, and this is going back to kind of what Connie and Amanda were talking about, is this, what are the gatekeepers? And that we rely on, you have to be able to play a band instrument, an orchestra instrument, be able to sing Western art songs. And those are kind of like those three check marks someone has to hit to get into music school. But when you look at that through K-12 education, you're getting this lack of re-entry. And so you have a kid who's 10, 11, 12 years old, and that's when they get to pick their instrument. And I challenge this notion of, why are we expecting a fourth or fifth grader to know that they want to go to music school when they're 8 years from now? And so often in so many districts, my district was the same, that once you quit, you can't come back. And once you leave that moment of no longer playing your instrument, you don't have any more music education. And that's frustrating. And you sit there and it's like, how are you going to deny someone this part of their education that is so important to this holistic learner? And so we really need to think about, in K-12, how can we identify that pipeline and allow re-entry into the pipeline in different formats? And so one of the things that I really try to do as a teacher is break out of that, like, band, orchestra, choir idea and think about not just music making, but creating musical experiences for myself and for my students. And it's through those experiences that allows kids to stay engaged with their music education. In Madison, I worked on a grant to provide access to music education for high school students using music technology through the public libraries, because we know that kids are, like Connie said, kids are using technology at home. They have their Macs, their iPads, and they're using GarageBand or whatever software they're using, but we aren't recognizing that as a formal aspect of music education. And I think now with COVID happening, along with Black Lives Matter, because when you look at the students that are primarily doing that, it's our students of color, speaking in from, like, my experiences in Madison. And so there's this convergence of, we really have an opportunity, if we break outside this idea of band, orchestra, and choir, to engage these students and to look at the students who are not in our classrooms. That's what I spend most of my time doing. Who is not in my classroom? And how do I get them there? And so that's where I really think about, how can we break down this idea of band, orchestra, and choir? In terms of higher education, one of the best books I ever read, two of the best books I ever read, one being The Dreamkeepers by Dr. Gloria Ladson Billings. If you haven't read it, you totally should read it. It's about urban education and how do you educate students of color. And it was an eye-opening experience to read that book, even though I am a person of color, to see, like, this was her thought process when she was a public school teacher. and to then take ideas and concepts and to then apply that in my predominantly white school, where I am the only person of color in the school, both student and staff, and kind of flipping the notion, and how do I as a person of color not feel obligated to educate white people on my experiences as a person of color, but how do I engage them and make them part of that active learning experience? And then going back to Jaquan, this idea of teaching transculturally, not just multiculturally, or, you know, this idea of how do we dig deeper and teach across cultures and engage in that. And I think, Amanda, you're getting to that too, that the fact that multicultural education isn't accepted really at the collegiate level in music ed teacher programs, and how there's very few programs that offer that. Luckily, I was able to be in a program that did require that. But like, how do we get universities and schools of music to think about this notion and teaching trans culture, teaching across cultures, to engage more than just one idea? And in one of my classes with Professor Dobbs, she provided us a spectrum, and she put monocultural, multicultural, polycultural, and transcultural on a spectrum. And when you think about it, we often just like, oh, I taught multicultural, I taught Native American music, I can check that box. But that doesn't get us anywhere. And I think, Jaquan, you're getting that. It's not just about what they wear, what context that music was used in, but what are the nuances and intricacies that make that piece of music or whatever it is significant and impactful to that culture? And so this, and teaching transculturally is hard. And so when I'm planning, as I'm planning for this new year, as my first year, I'm really thinking, how do I accomplish that? And so I really am looking at, you know, using Black Lives Matter and COVID and using this virtual music experience opportunity kind of as my gateway to take my first steps into my first year teaching.
Christian, thank you. Jaquan, I'm going to put you in conversation with Christian, I guess, and also for the last question for you is, how might the College Music Society assist in that forward motion? And we've got some really wonderful conversations going on in the chat about some previous work. But I'd love to hear from you. And then we've got a few minutes to kind of circle around and catch up on some other questions.
Well, I think that these webinars are certainly a crucial catalyst in that aid, in that help, because we're here, you know, we're here and we're talking about it, and we're having these conversations in an open and honest setting. And so I think maintaining that courage and that openness to have these conversations is certainly very, very important. And just continuing to be an advocate and checking in, whatever that may mean or however that may be. But you know, it's kind of, you know, what's in your wallet, you know, or what's in your classroom, what's in your toolbox, you know, what are you doing in your classroom, or what are you doing in your environment, in your community, or within yourself for that matter, to further the discussion and further the education in terms of diversity and multiculturalism, or I tend to lean towards the term of, what are you doing in a multicultural education or an anti-racist education, as it were? What are you doing? And so that's kind of how I think sometimes in terms of what can I do? Well, you know, what are you doing now? And then let's build off of that. And so I think that continuing to have these conversations is definitely it's very good for me to see and to be a part of. And so you know, I think there's some I think there's some trepidation many times on maybe not knowing what to say or when to say it or how to say it, you know, how to ask. And so, you know, I think definitely seeking out the resources and then and then just seeking out the resources and asking, you know, how can what can we do, you know, or just checking in periodically just to be sure, and or just to see what everyone's doing. And so that's just, I guess, that's my kind of, you know, brief, succinct, kind of all-inclusive way of thinking about that. But I definitely I love the idea of having this discussion here in this webinar for sure. It's just really great to me.
Jaquan, thank you so much. It's so important to hear these perspectives, especially from the younger people coming into the profession who are already there, really important. So circling back, we're now at the top of the hour. We've got 15 more minutes and I'd like to open it up. There's, you know, concerns about, you know, multicultural music education as being over here and not embedded, you know, within the core curriculum. What is the core curriculum? Who would like to, and then also, you know, comments about, you know, recent College Music Society task force on, you know, restructuring the Bachelor's in Music degree and dealing with the core curriculum. So is there anyone who'd like to, Tony, thank you, please.
Well, I want to say this about the whole idea about core curriculum, and especially with all of the various fundings now that is going towards education, but there are also other realms, especially when we start dealing with social-emotional learning, when we're dealing with extended day programming in terms of before school, after school, weekend. I like to encourage the new teachers and for our college, our professors and everything, to think about how they're going to inform our students about looking beyond what's in the curriculum and tapping into not only, you know, say in the curriculum, but also to looking at resources to help out with that budget. Because I've been very successful in working with after school programs, and there has been a large amount of money that's been able to be tapped into to help the curriculum. So it's like working piggyback, you know, and I think one of the things that's happening in education now, and especially because, you know, people are trying to say, well, here's curriculum and here's after school, et cetera. But now they're meshing very well. And if you think about it, we're all here about educating kids. We're all here about educating the community. So I always ask this, like, the question of everybody, what makes me different, quote unquote, me being in the classroom for, you know, 10 years, and then I went downtown to become an administrator. Now I'm overseeing after school. What makes me different than what I was in the classroom? That's why I got into this business. That's why I got into what we do, right? And so look at the various peripheries and figure out how you can incorporate those things into your programs, whether it's buying music or under instruments or whatever it is, bringing in professionals to work with you developing your sections, or bringing in guest speakers to talk about the various transcultural things, et cetera. Those things are very important. You know, I think building the camaraderie and building a team per se, and kind of think of more from a business model as opposed to that you have to be the sole provider and what you do, you know, and for the colleges to think that when your students leave to go out into the real world, is that we have to still foster that mentorship, that connectivity, and we want to check in. Hey, how are you doing? I remember I had one of my professors, I still have him, I'm a kind of a pack rat, but one of my professors from college, he would write me a letter after he saw the band and marching in the Rose Parade. He would say, hey, you look great, blah, 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 blah. Man, that brought me up, you know, knowing somebody is, you know, still caring, and someone from different levels. And so understanding that we're, you know, the community that we're in, whether it be the College Music Society, or whether it be NAFME, whether it be Jazz Education Network. Those things are so important for us to gather that information, for us to be the catalyst to help to keep it going. So think about these walls are being torn down for a reason. How do we, when we go back rebuilding, how do we rebuild these walls so that we are incorporating and that we are not forgetting this time here, so that we can make our future a lot better?
Definitely. Thank you, Tony. I'd like to kind of go back to our professors, Connie, Janet, and Amanda, and invite you to kind of bring things together and help us focus toward what are our next steps. Where do you think we ought to go?
Well, I'm sitting here thinking about things I've heard, and especially Amanda, thinking about how it feels to me like you are in an environment that is more change averse than some I've heard, right? And we all know that in our schools and institutions of higher ed, sometimes we're in places where the contingencies around us have openings and we can see what those openings are. And sometimes we feel like there are walls and barriers and there are things that we can't even begin to dislodge or move. And so one of the things that I think CMS might do, and NASM and NAFME and every alphabet in the world, the reason that we have professional associations is because they're loosely organized networks, right? And the whoever is in the leadership team of a professional association stands at a spot where they can look over the landscape and see that there are these little pockets of change. There are places where people are doing really phenomenal things, or they don't have to be spectacularly different things. They can be just moving in the right direction kinds of activities, right? And when you are in a professional association like that, through conferences and through the activities you do, you get wind of those. You know where those are. In an era, back to the pandemic, where our face-to-face conferences right now have to be rethought, I'm wondering if our professional associations and accrediting agencies could see their roles in a different way to name or provide a forum for people to show, well, how are you revising your core curriculum? Can we have a few case studies of that? Can we have a few visions of that? Because I think sometimes if you're in a place where people are change averse, it's because they haven't seen anything that looks different from what they know, right? So our professional associations might take on the challenge of saying, we're gonna be the clearinghouse for some of these ideas that could take hold in other places. And we're gonna try to disseminate those as widely as we can so that people can begin to envision the changes that we want through tangible actions people are already making. This is such a huge list of things that we want to accomplish, right, in schools of music and in music education, that we need to see examples, we need to see cases, we need to be able to envision the kinds of change that we want. And that could be a wonderful role of a professional association, just an idea.
And maybe that could be a next step for CMS. So Connie, what would you have to, could you respond and add to that, please?
Yeah, I could. I mentioned a little bit earlier on how change has to occur in a variety of places. I was speaking at the time about the point of entry into collegiate music study, but I think simultaneously, if we are going to see any kind of change, and I'm speaking specifically about with regard to issues related to Black Lives Matter, social justice in music education, cultural diversity in music education, these changes, there has to be disruption in several places. And I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about with regard to professional associations like our National Music Ed Association and our constituent state music education associations. When I had the opportunity to talk to music program leaders, one of the things I asked them about with regard to culturally responsive teaching is take a look at what programs you are highlighting in your particular districts. Are you highlighting programs that are inclusive? Or are you highlighting programs that follow our traditional programs? And the reason I asked about that is because no matter what we might do with pre-service teachers, there is a reward system that is there waiting for them after they become in-service teachers. And currently that reward system values tradition for the most part. And oftentimes I've found that our music education associations also highlight and reward and recognize excellence in terms of the traditional paradigm. And so if we are going to expand what excellence looks like in music education, then I think we need to expand how we reward and value different types of music programs so that we are recognizing and validating the work that a lot of music educators are engaging in that actually do speak to the desires and goals of students, which brings me to changes that can happen in P-12 music education. I think one of the biggest questions that we fail to encourage our pre-service music teachers to ask of our students is, what do you want to do musically? And how can I help you do that? Because typically in our P-12 system, from a preschool or kindergarten through fifth grade, maybe sixth grade, if the elementary school goes that far, we have a fairly democratic approach to teaching where every student in the school, if they're fortunate enough to have a general music teacher, will have general music. But we know that as we go to middle school and as we go to high school, those numbers begin to narrow and they become much more exclusive. And that for a lot of teachers, especially at the high school level, the focus is, even though it's on music making, a lot of times if you find a student who is talented in a particular way, and often that way is from a Western European construct, these are the students that are pushed forward to apply to music school. And I think it would be really, really helpful if we could perhaps change the dispositions of our teachers at all of those levels and help them focus more on how can I, as a music teacher, understand that part of my role is to find out how my students are musical, find out their musical goals, whatever they may be, and offer ourselves to assist them in that. And by that, I don't mean that we, and this has been mentioned before, and I'm so glad to hear it, we're not the people who, we don't all have the information, right? But what we can do is we can facilitate. It's really important, I think, for us to help our students learn, our pre-service teachers learn how to facilitate so that if you don't have the information and knowledge base regarding a culture's music making, you know where to find somebody who does. And I believe that if we rethink what it means to be a music educator, if we expand that notion, if we consider that our students come to our classrooms with a music knowledge base, and it's not just us inscribing knowledge on, you know, their brain pans, but they come to us, as one of the teachers that I interviewed said, they come to us with something. They have information about the music that has meaning for them and that has cultural meaning for them. We need to acknowledge that, we need to value that, and we need to utilize that as a bridge to new learning for them, because that's also a part of our responsibility as music educators. So I really think that, you know, we have to begin to rethink what music education is. We have to rethink our roles as music educators, and we have to understand that change needs to happen in a variety of points in order for it to be substantive and long-lasting.
Thank you so much, Connie. Thank you, Janet, Christian, Tony, Jaquan, Amanda, for this wonderful opportunity to learn from you and to be with you in this project at this moment in time. We are at time, it's 12:14, heading up to 12:15 Central Standard Time, or as I prefer to call it, Madison time. So thank you so much. And I look forward to continuing the conversation. Bill, I will turn it back to you.
Thanks so much, Terry. I really appreciate it. Colleagues, this has been a real honor to be with you for this last hour and a half, almost 2 hours that we've been together. To those attending, I hope you found this special College Music Society webinar professionally stimulating and valuable for your own work. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback and further questions for CMS related to these extraordinary times. I would also encourage you to consult the CMS website regularly for updates regarding our response to the pandemic and other current issues. On music.org, you will find a main menu item called COVID-19 Resources that includes links to teaching materials, archived webinars, musician health-related resources, and a listing of CMS and non-CMS events. Early next week, this webinar recording will be posted there. Now, on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I also want to thank our panelists, Jaquan Wiley, Tony White, Amanda Soto, Constance McCoy, Christian Bonner, and Janet Ravel Barrett, and our moderator, Terrell Dobbs, for sharing their expertise, and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for good health and brilliant teaching, planning, and music making as we look toward the new academic year.